He arrives. That's the stadium just in the background there. 9 different stadia, incidentally, will be used for this tournament. Might be quite familiar, of course, after the World Cup was held here just 14 months ago. It is a truly spectacular sight. And while we wait for the Emir's arrival, let me just give you a rough idea of how this tournament is going to work. 24 nations, as I mentioned. It gives us 6 groups of 4. The top 2 teams in each group will qualify for the round of 16, and then the 4 best third place teams as well. Obviously, after that, there are no second chances, straight knockout. And we are expecting a full house inside the stadium tonight, because the host nation and the defending champions Qatar taking on Lebanon in the opening match of the tournament. It will be also an historic event for several other reasons, one of which is we're going to have the semi-automated offside technology system, which uses 12 specialized cameras, and it also uses artificial intelligence, and that's going to be in use at all 51 matches. First time it'll be in place at an AFC competition, and it also makes the AFC the first confederation to apply that system at the continental men's national team level. It's a glittering metropolis, isn't it? Doha by night. And I think you're really going to enjoy the set design for the opening ceremony, which represents a desert, but probably not like a desert you've ever seen before. It's very, very clever indeed. Down the years, Japan has been the most successful nation in the history of the AFC Asian Cup. They've won it 4 times. Iran and Saudi Arabia have 3 each. Korea Republic 2, although not for a long, long time. A lot of speculation. This might be the year that Korea Republic, led by the legendary German Jürgen Klinsmann, could end a 64-year drought. Five other nations have won this event once, including the hosts and defending champions Qatar. Their group also includes China, Tajikistan, which is in fact the only nation making their AFC Asian Cup debut here, and Lebanon. Some of the other fancied nations, Australia, they're in with Uzbekistan, Syria and India. United Arab Emirates are going to have, you would imagine, quite a few supporters here. They're in with Iran, another fancied nation, along with Hong Kong and Palestine. Japan are also one of the favourites. They'll be facing Indonesia, Iraq and Vietnam in Group D. In Group E, South Korea, Klinsmann's side against Malaysia, Jordan and Bahrain. And then in Group F, Saudi Arabia, who again will have their supporters here. Thailand, Kyrgyz Republic and Oman are the other nations that make up Group F. So there are the 24 teams, and as I say, the action starts tonight. Currently just gone 5:20 local time. It's a 7 p.m. kickoff later for the opener, Qatar versus Lebanon. The opening ceremony is titled The Lost Chapter of Kalila and Dimna. It's a prominent literary work across Asia, but this is a new chapter. And we're promised that it's going to stay true to the fable-like qualities of the original, which were a series of stories, all of which had a very clear message. And what you're going to see shortly tonight will also have a strong message to take from it. It's going to be a five-act narration. It combines music with some top-class performers, incidentally. The set design, I think you'll agree when you see it, is stunning. We've got some dazzling costumes, some incredible pyrotechnic effects. And what the aim was to draw inspiration from the diverse cultures of all the competing countries in this competition here in Qatar. And I will try and guide you through it once it starts. Just try and explain exactly what's going on and what the meaning of it is. No mean feat to organise an event of this magnitude. Roads have to be closed, diversions have to be put in place, got to make sure there's parking for everybody. There is actually also a subway system here, so I would imagine many of the supporters will be arriving by that method on the train. And this is the cortege that is bringing His Highness the Emir Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani to the stadium. Which just looks magnificent in gold, doesn't it? Wonderful feat of engineering, the Lusail Stadium. It is the largest stadium in Qatar, and the Middle East actually by capacity. Just shy of 89,000 can fit in here. And His Highness is on the way, and those pictures just being relayed to the crowd, and you can probably hear their reaction. His Highness has reigned since 2013, and he actually has a huge passion for sport. Was heavily involved in both the Asian Games held here back in 2006 and, of course, much more recently, the 2022 FIFA World Cup. And you also get the feeling that his love of sport has translated itself to so many of the Qatari people. And having hosted the biggest football tournament on earth just over a year ago, you can imagine their level of excitement to now stage the AFC Asian Cup Qatar 2023. Which in terms of a number of viewers is second only to the World Cup amongst every football competition in the world. So His Highness the Emir Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani making his way to the VIP balcony.
Please welcome His Highness Sheikh Tamim bin Hamad Al Thani, Emir of the State of Qatar.
And there's the welcome. Doesn't need words. So this is the stage for the opening ceremony. We couldn't ask for a more dramatic one, could we? Themes of the ceremony: inclusion, respect, and celebrating our differences. Here's Ava Nema, Lebanese singer, with the first song, An Ode to the Landscape.
شدت مرة في جدوى أن تبقى صخرة وثار رملها من أسر كانت الرمال كانت لا تزال كانت لا تزال الرمال فكرة الحياة لتبقى حلو وجه الليل في عصف القصوى كلما تصرخ عاصفة ترقص الرمال تلالا كلما
Notice the fan engagement badges, 80,000 of them, they're LED devices, so that the fans are thoroughly involved. And that song basically awakens the flora and fauna and the birds. And the man approaches and he's angry at his reflection. Now there are the two guardians of the desert, the two jackals, Kalila in red and Dimna in blue. And they notice the man is angry at his reflection because he spotted some flaws. Man is played by the acclaimed Qatari actor Michel Aldasari. And the message of this song is that you should embrace your flaws because they make you human. The two jackals, wise siblings who embark on endless journeys and adventures, and they're trying to set him straight. That's a great shot of those fan engagement badges. Should tell you also, you see the rose petals there? 600,000 individual rose petals. Took someone a while to make those.
لا تخاف لو تخاف لو ت
Set design is stunning, isn't it? Desert just doesn't represent the geography of Qatar and the surrounding region, but it serves as a metaphor for its people as well. The power of unity. Individual grains of sand that scattered by the wind and then come together to form dunes strong enough to withstand anything. We still need some convincing. If you're wondering about the choreography, by the way, directed by one of the world's most renowned mass choreographers, Dimitra Kukikidi. Dimitra wanted to create an intimate but also a theatrical atmosphere. He wants to throw away the mirror still. Galila and Dimna will keep pressing the point that that's not the right thing to do. I think the message might just be starting to get through.
لا تدفن العيوب في الرمال لا تغطي العيوب كل الرمال لا تدفن العيوب الا في القلوب.
The set, by the way, made up of 240 individual pieces that basically fit together like a jigsaw. I think this is one of the most spectacular parts of the opening ceremony. These five LED mirrors, each one of them is 11 meters long, and the fact there's five of them is not a coincidence. They represent the five AFC regions. And as you can see, they're LED mirrors. Colossal mirror of petals. Well, the message that our two heroes trying to put across is that within imperfections lie the most distinctive facets of our character. Real state-of-the-art technology. We're going to see 24 different animal characters as well. Blend of theatrical and cinematic flair, these characters.
لا تدفن العيوب.
see those LED badges still flashing brightly in the spectator areas of the stadium. And enlightenment literally has arrived for the man.
من أنت؟
نحن رأي أرضك أن لا يدفن بعضك بعضك.
Attention to detail in these costumes. Absolutely phenomenal.
ألي أجلي خرج الرمل من طوره ليقول لي من أنا ما أنا ما أكثركم ما أقلي أمن أجلي
أنت في عين الكون كون ألسنا واحدا في ألف لون؟
سأصدق أن الضعف اختراع وأن حلمي رعية وأن قلبي يرى سأصدق.
Original story, by the way, was by the Kuwaiti writer Biba Hamada, known for her work in TV series, musicals and commercials. And then they turned her words into a fully-fledged musical. Ahab Abdel composed the music for this opening ceremony. It was produced by Nada Hamdi. And the clapping symbolizes that the man now understands he has to embrace his flaws. Let's enjoy some of the music.
التصفيق هو الفريق لو ينطق لا 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 فنحن لو تدقق لو تدقق إنسان واحد كبير جميل متفرق فنحن لو تدقق لو تدقق لو تدقق إنسان واحد كبير جميل متفرق
فينا موقف نحفر أعمق 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 نحن غروبنا حتى نصدق صدق صدق
أننا نكمل بعد لنشرق
نحن المشرق نحن المشرق
باب الشمس الذي لا يغلى
سأصفق لك فصفق لي صفق
واو 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 واو
نحن صادقنا الهواء 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 والقرار للجناح للرياح للرياح
نحن سرعة نحن تمويه الذكاء نحن توأم الصحراء
الصحراء الصحراء
أصبر من نخل على ماء
على الماء على الماء
نحن لوحة السماء فناننا أوفياء.
Lyrics of the song saying that the man's weaknesses can grow into strengths and that the beauty of the world prevails here this evening.
سأصفق لك فصفق لي صفق
The man now understands that the greatest weakness is failing to acknowledge the unique and memorable qualities that define us all. Well, how spectacular is that? Serious pyrotechnics going on.
أصدق أحلق ما دمتم بانتظاري سأشرق إنما جئنا نذكر أنك كل ما تقرر
أنك لما تريد تقدر والآن نرجع كل في مكانه مبدع
وأنت اللاعب واللعبة والمشجع وهذا الهدف الذي يبصر ويسمع.
Man now understands it's not about how the mirror reflects him, but about how he chooses to see himself in his own reflection. Song saying that he will soar and won't stand still. Just about every animal on the stage now. Those impressive birds flying around as well, the falcons. Choreography has been just about foot perfect, you might say. Almost time for the animals to return to the mythical land from which they came. Their work is pretty much done, along with our two heroes, Khalila and Dimna. I think they got full value out of those costumes, though.
نقترب من بعض كتفا في كتف
ولنحب بعضنا
And now it's up to you.
حتى نكون الهدف
هدف 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 أتدري ما معنى الهدف والحياة تعترف فينا أخيرا تعترف ولا شباك توقف قلبا خلق كي لا يقف ولا شباك حولنا لا شباك لا لا لا
How impressive are those individual Khalila and Dimna huge balloons. In 11 metres high, 12 metres long, and over 6,000 individual fireworks going off at the Lusail Stadium. Well, I think the message has come across pretty strongly to encourage people to believe in themselves, focus on their goals despite any doubts, because our individuality is what makes us unique. And the final part of the story is celebration of the journey we've just witnessed here, and also, of course, the start of the tournament itself.
الحضور الكريم، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. جرى العرف أن يقوم كابتن الدولة المستضيفة بأداء قسم البطولة، وأنه لشرف لي أن أكون من يقوم بأداء القسم، ولكن أستأذنكم بأن أمنح حق تأدية قسم البطولة لزميلي مصعب البطاط كابتن منتخب فلسطين.
Song is a Malala style arrangement.
باسمي ونيابة عن زملائي أقسم بالله العظيم المنتصر للنور على العتيم أقسم بأن نلتزم بشريعة المنافسة الشريفة قانونا وعرفا روحا ومضمونا وأن أنقل للجمهور ما يعكس خلق القويم والله على ما نقول شهيد.
Just looking around the stadium, it appears as though pretty much every seat almost is full, and we're still more than an hour and 10 minutes away from, or just under an hour and 10 minutes away from kickoff in our opening match.
Shamirina liya
What a spectacular ending to a phenomenal opening ceremony. If the football is as good as what we've just seen, we're going to be in for a treat over the next month or so. Remember, the first match comes up in just over an hour. It is Qatar versus Lebanon. For now, though, from all of us here at the Lusail Stadium, hope you've enjoyed the opening ceremony. Goodbye for the moment.
That was absolutely fantastic. Let's have a look now at a great video about how Qatar won the last AFC Asian Cup.
سيدات وسادة، أسعد الله مساكم ونجدد التحية والترحيب فيكم في استاد لوسيل، هذا الاستاد المونديالي. والآن لسنا مجرد إعلاميين في قسم الترفيه الإعلامي، نود أن نبني علاقة معكم ونوطدها. كل مرة تسمعون كلمة هيا على الكاميرا، كل ما عليكم فعله هو ترديد آسيا، لنشكل معا الهاشتاج الرسمي لهذه البطولة الرائعة. خلونا نجرب مع بعض. هيا
أيجا،
هيا
Asia!
Hiya!
Asia!
Fantastic, that was really good, Salman. We got everybody going, which was absolutely magnificent. So what Salman was telling all of you is that as part of the official hashtags here for this tournament, one of those is Hiya Asia. So anytime, at any point you hear us say Hiya, you say Asia. Let's try it again, Salman. Ready, everybody? Hiya!
كابتن حسن يعطيك الصحة والعافية، نرحب فيك. أول مباراة لكم، مباراة كبيرة أمام المنتخب القطري، كيف تشوف هذه المباراة؟ أعتقد متشوق لهذه المباراة أنت وأجواء حماسية، كيف تشوف هذه المباراة؟
صحيح، يعني بعتقد من أول القرعة كل اللاعبين كانوا متحمسين ليلعبوا مباراة الافتتاح أمام المنتخب القطري. مباراة صعبة، مباراة أولى مع المنتخب القطري، ما عم نقول حتكون برأيي حتكون مباراة كتير صعبة، بس أنك تلعب مباراة افتتاح أول مباراة بالبطولة، أعين الكل على اللاعبين، هاي بيعطي حافز لكل اللاعبين أنه يعطوا بشكل أفضل. طبعا زائد التركيز العالي اللي اشتغلنا فيه بهيدي الفترة، المدرب عطى كل التعليمات، بعتقد صرنا كلنا جاهزين للمباراة ونتمنى التوفيق من رب العالمين.
كابتن حسن، الكل ينتظرك انت كابتن، وممكن تكون هذه آخر مشاركة لك، كيف تشوف هذه الأجواء الجميلة؟
صحيح، يعني أنا سبق وأعلنت أنه هي آخر بطولة كأس آسيا لإلي، وحتكون يمكن آخر سنة لإلي مع المنتخب على المستوى الدولي. طبعاً حستمتع بكل دقيقة بهيدي البطولة، وبكل لحظة أصلاً رح يكون الوقت اللي حقضيه بعد مع المنتخب، لأنه أجمل شيء اللاعب أنه الأوقات اللي بيقضيها مع منتخب بلد اللي بيخدم فيها بلده، هيدا أجمل شعور للاعب، وإن شاء الله بتمنى كون عطيت كل شيء عندي أقدر كانت ساعات للعيبة الصغار.
الجماهير اللبنانية تنتظر المنتخب اللبناني، وين بيروح المنتخب اللبناني؟
صح، مثل ما قلت نحن حتى ما نحط ضغوطات على حالنا، واضح نحن كان الهدف تبعولنا نطلع كأفضل ثالث، أو إذا ساعدتنا لظروف كتاني ما حنضغط حالنا، عارفين صعوبة المجموعة، بس كمان جايين مركزين وعندنا هدف بدنا نحاول نتأهل للدور الثاني.
موفقين يا كابتن. شكرا.
شكرا.
يعطيك العافية.
So I reminded myself that when we're on the football pitch, we might support different sides. But off the football pitch, what we want to do is unify everybody here inside Lusail Stadium. So we've got a little game we want to play with all of you out there.
Coach, nice to meet you. How are you first?
Good evening. Coach,
good evening. Strong game against Qatar, first game. What do you think about for today?
Strong game. I respect a lot Qatar team. They are actually winner of the Asia Cup. I respect the results they reach the last Asia Cup, and also with this is team from World Cup. But I am sure that my players are ready, and we are proud to play this game. We are ready to show our possibilities, and we will do our the best to represent Lebanese football on the best way.
Coach, before you with the national team, how did the relation with the player? You come back again, I think have good relation for good result.
I have a good relationship and nice memories from last time I were here, but half team is changed. Now is a little younger group. I believe that young players will give us positive energy for good result in the future.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. 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 Yes, indeed. So.
مساء الخير نرحب بالمدرب طبعا معنا اول شيء ثاني شيء مباراه كبيره اليوم تنتظر المنتخب القطري امام المنتخب اللبناني في اولى المباريات للمنتخب القطري وايضا اولى مباريات المدرب كيف يشوف هذا الافتتاح وهذه المباراه القويه الصعبه
Al principio le damos la bienvenida aquí y es el primer partido para usted con la selección qatarí y también el primer partido en el torneo el partido inaugural cómo ve usted este partido
Bueno, muchas gracias. Bueno, partido más de fútbol con un gran ambiente. Esperemos que los jugadores devuelvan este apoyo de nuestra afición en nuestro campo, en nuestra ciudad, en nuestro país. Entonces, espero que los jugadores den el máximo y el fútbol es un juego y no sabemos qué va a pasar. Pero sobre todo importante que los jugadores disfruten del ambiente y disfruten del partido.
طبيعة الحال هي مباراة كبيرة مباراة كرة قدم في أجواء كبيرة أيضا ونأمل من اللاعبين أن يردوا الدعم الذي رأيناه في المدرجات من الجماهير داخل الملعب وداخل الميدان
Good luck إن شاء الله Thank you
Thank you Gracias
في أمور ما تغير حسنا مثل أول جدود عسل ويستمر حتى درجة سنة 88 صحيح إن كل شيء تغير بعد إلا شيء واحد هو اللي كمل لنا لمة العيلة لمتنا مثل الأول ما تغيرت الإسراع عندنا هي أغلى فوز ممكن بمناسبة كأس آسيا والسبت تغير ولا تغير
Yeah. 5 years ago, Qatar won the AFC Asian Cup in the UAE, and tonight they kick off the defence of their trophy in their home country as Lebanon provide the first opposition. It's the opening match of the AFC Asian Cup 2023 at the magnificent Lusail Stadium in Qatar. Well, the glittering opening ceremony a little earlier on, and all the ceremony that goes with this big tournament, all coming to the fore here in a stadium that just over a year ago hosted the World Cup final, of course. And this is the first game, and that is the makeup of Group A. Also in the group, China, who've appeared in every edition since making their debuts in 1976. And the only debutants in the competition this year, that is Tajikistan. Very much the unknown quantity at this level, you would feel. But Qatar and Lebanon will certainly feel that they will be among the favourites in the group to go through. With potentially three teams going through from these groups, it is 16 teams that will make it through from the 24 that start this competition. So plenty to play for over the next few days. A win in your opening game, though, puts you in very good stead in the group. And Qatar know that the pressure is on them in front of a home crowd that expects nothing less than success. The man, of course, who guided them in 2019, Felix Sanchez, is no longer in charge. It is a new man at the helm, Marquez Lopez, who hasn't had too much time to work with the team. And it is a little bit cooler in Qatar at this time of year, hence the reason that the tournament is a similar kind of year across the winter months rather than the summer months, when it does get blisteringly hot here. But it is very pleasant conditions for these two sets of teams tonight as we await the rival of the two teams. As we said, you know, a lot of pressure on Qatar to do well in this tournament, but they've got the experience. There are a lot of players in the squad that played in 2019, and they will certainly expect nothing less than a win.
Yes, there's been lots of talk about that expectation, about the pressure on the shoulders of the Qatari players after the disappointment of that World Cup campaign. There wasn't much of that pressure when they won the competition back in 2019. It was a stellar run to the trophy. Now everyone is watching on to see if they can repeat that feat with that home support. Lebanon for them, as we see Miodrag Radulovic coming out of the tunnel. For them, it's an opportunity to create some history here by trying to become the first side in Lebanon's history at the AFC Asian Cup to make it past the group stage.
It is Lebanon's third appearance in AFC Asian Cup finals. For Qatar, 11 appearances. They were superb in 2019. They won all seven games on their way to becoming champions. And of course, Amo Ezzali broke Ali Dai's tournament record, scoring 9 goals into the bargain. And he will certainly be the danger man for the host nation as we go through these three opening games.
Just had a look at some of the players in there in the tunnel. Hassan Matouk is going to have to play a big part for Lebanon. Got some quality on the bench, some fresh talent coming through. There we have Hassan Al Haidos leading the way for Qatar ahead of Fakram Afif. He'll be one of their key players in attack, an outstanding talent. Qatar's number 11, and just behind him, Al Muez Ali at number 19. Doesn't score too many goals on the domestic front, does really well for them on the international stage.
It always rises to the occasion in the big matches, but as we say, there are one or two familiar names within that lineup. Pedro, the fullback Al Haidos Almoez, who all featured. In fact, Al Haidos also played in 2015 as well. He's made 175 appearances for the national team now, quite an incredible record since making his debut. You mentioned that it was a disappointing World Cup campaign for Qatar. Of course, there's always a lot of pressure on the host nation when you go into these tournaments, but maybe there was a little bit more pressure on them because they were the holders of the AFC Asian Cup going into that tournament just over 12 months ago.
Look, there's a lot of that expectation, again, as whether these players can sort of deal with that pressure. And there's been a lot of fighting talk in the build-up to this competition coming out from Qatar's players about how they've learned from that experience. We'll get to find out exactly how much they've learned. Similarities between these two sides, the fact that they've had coaching changes in recent times as well, not exactly the best in terms of their preparation. So we'll see how that goes along. Lots of experience with both starting lineups. We know how important this first game of the competition is. Lebanon, if they can pick up a win, will give themselves a fantastic platform to go on and progress from this group. I think even a point for Lebanon will be a good result in this one. Matouk spoke about how important this game is against Qatar because he sees them as the strongest side in this group. And for Qatar, I mean, again, go back to that expectation. Can they deliver under that pressure here in this beautiful venue?
Yeah, the venue that will only be used for two games, the opening game and the final. Of course, it's just over 12 months ago that Argentina met France here in the World Cup final. Massive occasion, and it's been great being around Doha over the last few days because all the branding's up. And, you know, when they do things in this part of the world, they do it right in terms of organisation, and everything is spot on. We saw that dramatic opening ceremony earlier on with fireworks and teaching us a little bit about Qatar's history. And it really is a wonderful thing to be a part of the whole system around the event at the moment as well.
I think we arrived into Qatar a few days ago, and you really get the sense of just how big this competition is, just how much it means. And if you've been following Asian football from a young age, like I have, if you've been a fan growing up, this is a competition that means so much, and you understand exactly why. If you're just joining us, welcome along. The more, the merrier. For fans of Asian football, stick with the competition, and you'll see exactly why we all love it so much. But yes, there's lots of excitement here, Mark.
Well, it does seem like an absolute age since Qatar lifted that trophy in the UAE, not too far from here, nearly 5 years ago now. But here come the two teams. Been waiting down in the tunnel an awfully long time. I'm sure there'll be a few nerves around from some of the younger members of these two squads, but when we were chatting earlier, we were saying they are two vastly experienced sides as well, even though, you know, some of the players haven't played anywhere near the matches that Al Haidos have played. Of course, they have played a lot of international football over the last 5 years to get to this stage of the competition. You know the drill. We will have the two teams' national anthems before we get things underway. It'll be Lebanon, followed by the anthem of the host nation, Qatar.
Qatar.
This is the 18th edition of the AFC Asian Cup. Five cities hosting 51 matches across the next month or so, all bidding to lift silverware at the end of this trophy. Japan, of course, the most successful team with four titles to their name. But there are lots of little side issues here. We mentioned the debutants, Tajikistan, Hong Kong returning after 56 years, Indonesia and Malaysia both qualifying for the first time since they were the joint hosts in 2007. Tajikistan becoming the 37th different team to play in this competition, and they get their campaign underway tomorrow against China. Well, that rather large trophy is being led away as we take a look at the two teams. Afif Al-Haidos and Al-Moez adding that experience. Well, Youssef will be the main central striker for Qatar. There are some familiar names in there. Say four of those players started the final 4 years ago. Their experience will rub off on some of those younger players. Al-Haidos wears the captain's armband, as does Matu for Lebanon. Another player with over 100 appearances to his name. Alireza Fighani from the Islamic Republic of Iran is our referee. Two assistants from Australia, and Ko Hyung Jin from Korea Republic is the fourth official. Kate Jasovic, Sean Evans from Australia are in charge of the VAR room. And here is the Lebanon team, 3-5-2 formation for them. Nour Mansour is one of the most experienced of the three centre-backs in front of goalkeeper Matar. Mohamed Haidar played in the 2019 edition. Nasser Nasser is the least experienced of the midfielders in that midfield five, while Hassan Matuk, as we said, Lebanon's most capped player and top goal scorer. He'll lead the way as they look to make the knockouts for the first time. And as in these international competitions, the remainder of the squad, 26 players in the squads, all available off the bench in these days now, of course, where coaches do have the luxury of making five substitutions. Makes a massive difference, doesn't it, those five substitutes from the old days. But it's slightly bizarre to think you can change half your outfield personnel at some point during the course of the match.
It certainly helps, and it certainly helps not just your in-game management, but your workload and how you manage the workloads of the players throughout the competition is something that will come into effect, will come into play as this competition carries on. We just have a look at Lebanon and that setup in terms of the back three. Pretty standard, really, a 3-5-2 for Lebanon under Miodrag Radulovic. We saw this from him back in 2019 as well. He's a coach who wants to make sure that his side are defensively very solid. And they have that platform in terms of the back three and the two midfielders in front of them, in Shaw and Tanaish. And then just ahead of them, Omar Haidar, the number 10, will be expected to play those passes into the likes of Matuk and Girardi.
Well, it is Qatar that get us underway. The opening match as they host the tournament that they won back in 2019. It'll be interesting to see how they get underway here. The format, of course, changed in 2019 when it went to a 2014 tournament for the first time, with the top two teams in each group qualifying automatically for the round of 16. And then four of the six third-place teams going through to join them as well. Miodrag Radulovic knows this is a good chance for Lebanon this time, having missed out in the last edition. But if you can avoid defeat, or if you can pick up points in your opening game, it always gives you a very good grounding for the remainder of the tournament with those positions available.
When you think back to their campaign in 2019, Mark, and at times perhaps they were a little bit unfortunate. They scored first in the meeting against Qatar, that edition of the Asian Cup. That goal was disallowed. And it just sort of fell away. They gave Qatar and Saudi Arabia a tough time of it before opening up a little bit more against DPR Korea in the final match. Just wasn't enough. That disciplinary point system is going to come into it as well as the competition carries on.
That was a thief looking for that. Ball out to that far side. So that five in midfield will become five at the back, of course, when they're on defence, Lebanon, with Zayn and Nasser dropping back to become the wing-backs. First shooting chance of the game is straight have Matar, though, the goalkeeper. His position right, there was no real power in the shot. Well, Marquez Lopez, who only took charge of training at the end of December. Carlos Queiroz throwing a little bit of a spanner in the works when he left things towards the end of December. So the coach hasn't had much time to work with the team, but you would imagine he would just probably say, look, you know, keep do what you've been doing for the last few years and let's take it from there.
That'll be one of the messages he'll be passing through towards his players, or to his players, I should say. But the 62-year-old's very familiar with Qatari football, having been the head coach of Al Wakra since 2018, as we have a look at this effort coming in here. The first real test for Mata, getting the go-ahead in goal ahead of Madi Khalil.
Al Haidos. As he pulled back towards the feet, played off to Youssef. Ran out of play though, too much on that one as it came in. This is the first tournament that we've had VAR, by the way, right from the very first minute. It was for the quarter-finals onwards last time, and we've also got the semi-automated offside as well, which there's a lot of rows around the world these days about these tight offside decisions, but the hope is that this semi-automated system will make that life a little bit easier for the assistant referees in making those quick decisions. Fateh cutting it back to Barsham, who was starting to establish himself as the number one now for Qatar. Didn't play in that final 4 years ago. Saad is in the squad. So a good block from Haidar. Gives away the goal kick.
Now he'll want his side, Marquez Lopez, to get off to a very quick start. Played a good tempo here against the Lebanon side, who, as we'd expect them to set up in that back five, you don't want them to settle into that defensive shape. You don't want it to be played in front of that defensive block. You want to try and provoke those midfield lines and play it in behind if you can. Akram Afif we're seeing here as well, already drifting across from the left-hand side, moving into those central positions, trying to play in behind Lebanon's midfield. Let's take a look at that contact from Ahmad Fati, holding his position in central midfield alongside Abdelaziz Hatim. The concern for me with when it comes to Lebanon is it's all well and good being steady at the back, being strong and solid defensively. It's whether they can create enough, whether they can get the goals. And not too many goals in this squad overall. Hassan Matouk is the one that they'll be relying on. But aside from him, they are lacking goals in this side.
They have only scored 3 goals in their last 4 matches. They drew both of their 2026 World Cup qualification games back in November. Lost out to Saudi Arabia in a friendly last week, just by a single goal to nil. Qatar, by comparison, well, they've got plenty of goals in them. They put 8 past Afghanistan in their qualifier. Elmo Ezzali getting 4 in that game. Looking to control the early possession as well. This is Hatum. Elmo might get in behind here. It's Elmo Ezzali in a goal! First goal of the tournament goes Qatar's way. And wouldn't you know it, it's Elmo Ezzali. But I think the flag has gone up for offside. I don't think the flag did go up. I think it's the automated system that's disallowed the goal. Well, Elmo Ezzali's joy short-lived. And the Qatar players straight away around the referee.
Yeah, he's quite a ways off. There's a bit of a touch there from the defender. Now, potentially that could be interesting to sort of look at from the VAR's perspective. As if there was an intentional touch from the defender as he attempts to make that clearance. Is that an intentional play? Nothing wrong with that from Elmo Ezzali. Lovely finish as well, keeps his composure. The assistant referee on this near side was waiting to see how that attack would develop. Once it went in, took the opportunity to get his flag up there to signal. Well, that's something to be looked at, and it will be looked at. Warning there for Lebanon. The movement of Elmo Ezzali. This needs to be a little bit better timed.
Well, VAR have said it is no goal. So despite that touch, well, is that a controversial moment early on in the game? How many minutes have we played? Coming up to 7 minutes and already we've had a VAR intervention. You make a very good point, though, that the semi-automated would only pick up the players. It wouldn't pick up the touch from the defender if it's come through. So VAR would have been looking at the point that that pass was made, and Almo is positioned before that touch.
That's right. That's why they had to sort of take a look at that. And it's in those moments where if the VAR had deemed that it had taken a touch, and it could have been an intentional touch, they might have recommended an on-field review to the referee. Anyway, on we go. We'll take some encouragement from that, Qatar.
Ali Reza Fagani, as we said, is the referee. Comes from the Islamic Republic of Iran, but referees predominantly in the A-League in Australia these days. There's Pedro. Born in Portugal. Pedro is making his 93rd appearance for the national side tonight, normally known as Roro. There's Yusuf, who started through the middle but has come out to this near side. That's well intercepted by Nasser. Haven't seen much going forward as yet from Lebanon. Maybe that disallowed goal will just spark them into life a little. Fateh. Mendes. Lovely diagonal ball to Youssef. Afif just ducked underneath it, tries to play it back in again. There's a little bit too much on that, though. Comfortable for El Zain, who will watch it behind for the goal kick.
There's a lot of speed and mobility in that Qatari front line. Youssef Abdurizak just drifting out onto the right-hand side. Afif just playing in that position, as I mentioned. He'll go out onto the left and then drift in centrally. And you have Almoez Ali leading the line for them. Here's another look at that pass. Quite clearly offside there, the indication from the system.
Denied his first goal of the tournament. As we say, he scored 9 in the last edition, beating Ali Day's record of 8 in 1996. Ali Day was the leading international goalscorer until a couple of years ago when Cristiano Ronaldo passed him. Tremendous goal-scoring feats from both those players over their international careers. And this is a chance for Lebanon here. They've won themselves their first corner.
Final touch of Lucas Mendes. Just recently coming into the Qatari national team. Gives them nice balance. Left-footed central defender. Not too many of those across the world of football. Opens up those passing lanes and those passing channels. Left for the player in those positions.
Maybe Haidar with the corner. Slight hesitation. It was attacked by El Zain.
Was whipped in with good pace. Mendes was just right there in front of his goalkeeper, Barsham.
Lebanon looking to try and keep the pressure on here with a long throw. Four players inside the penalty area. It's a good height on that one, but dealt with again by the Qatar defence. Comes back out to Tanish, who... So a shot blocked. Tanish again. Tussling away, and eventually Qatar will get the ball clear. They do move the ball around quickly when they're going away from their own goal. It was Pedro, the furthest man forward.
Well, that is going to be one of the key things for Qatar in this match. Again, can they transition quickly? Catch Lebanon out on the counter-attack. Not established possession. Be difficult to break Lebanon down.
Was Almoez Ali going down? The flag did go up briefly, but the referee playing on with the ball in the hands of Mustafa Mata, who's okay after receiving treatment a few minutes ago. Miodrag Radulovic has been reanimated down on the sidelines, back at his second spell in Lebanon. Was it Montenegro in between. He did coach Lebanon back in 2019.
He had a good long spell, Radulovic, didn't he, in Lebanon. A very popular figure amongst the players. Just like Marcus Lopez, hasn't had too much time to work with his players.
Here's Youssef, angles tight. Always asking questions. It was a lovely little flick from Almoez to play him in, but Youssef just snatching at that one a little bit.
Really good to see that variation in play from Qatar. Just with the short passing game, going a little bit more direct, a longer pass from back to front. He's got a player in there, Almoez Ali, who's not just good at running into the channels and causing problems with his pace. We're also able to time his headers in the air. A real threat aerially. He's flicking it on for Youssef. That's a great challenge from Shur.
It's not a great ball, though. Missed the chance there to really put some pressure on. Haidar will be disappointed with that little ball just flicked forward. It seemed like a relatively straightforward pass, really, but just his technique letting him down. It's a throw into Qatar. They did qualify for this tournament, of course, Qatar. They won all but one of their qualifying matches, scoring plenty of goals in the process. They put six past Afghanistan. It's hard to believe that the qualifying for this tournament started way back in September 2019. Obviously, things all thrown out of sync because of the COVID outbreak and then centralised games. But it seems an awfully long time ago that these teams qualified for this. And there's been a lot of changes in a lot of the squads in terms of personnel over that time.
Just the personnel coaching changes as well along the way. It's that joint qualifying process. The AFC qualifiers qualifying for the World Cup and the Asian Cup. Doubling up in that sense. Now that's the nature of it all. You may have played a part in qualification. Find yourself out of the final squad once the competition starts.
Still goalless here in the opening match. Qatar did have a goal disallowed, though, from Almoez Ali, who is offside, as Haidar. El Zain. Mansour. Robert Milky playing that one forward. His brother George was in the original squad, but was a late withdrawal due to injury. George played 4 years ago, 5 years ago rather. Would have been interesting to have the two brothers in the squad, but denied the possibility of playing together.
Both very important players for Lebanon as well.
Matu. No real power in that one again. Starting to get one or two players forward into good positions now. It was Zain this time.
Easily getting past Mahdi. Lucas Mendes has gone down here under that challenge. Worrying signs for Qatar.
One of the international-born players in the Qatar squad who had a became a Qatari citizen. It's only his fourth appearance for the national team. Born in Curitiba in Brazil. Has played in Qatar a long time though. He was with El Jaish from 2014, so 9-year career already, coming up to 10. Here he is on the ball again. Didn't need any treatment, so nothing too serious. Wired down the line to Afif.
Just looking like they're in need of a little bit of a spark. Come from somewhere.
Well, they thought they'd be given that spark by Almoez Ali, of course, before the goal was disallowed. got the name Tintin Marquez Lopez when he was younger because he had a hairstyle similar to the cartoon character. As you can see, he's probably dispensed with that nickname now, I should think. There's Pedro. Your crossing was blocked, footed by Tanish. Fateh working well across that midfield line. These sides have met seven times previously. Lebanon have never beaten Qatar. Their only time they've not been beaten was a 1-1 draw in a World Cup qualifier back in 2013.
Fateh there, just on the ball in midfield, trying to control possessions. You have a look at those numbers, 63% for Qatar. We expected this. We expected Lebanon to be sitting back, quite happy to give possession to Qatar and try and hit on this counter-attacking situations. Just hasn't quite happened for them yet. They've been able to really construct those moves on the transition. Sure, just fouled by Almoez. He just has a look up here as he's trying to drive through midfield. Doesn't see too much going on in front of him, sure. That's why he has to delay that pass. Lots of energy, great work rate in central midfield. Olet Shur.
It was a driven free kick which was aimed towards the run of Nasser, but too much pace on it.
Have a look at Yusuf there as well, tracking back, working hard without the ball. For Qatar, building up with this back three, you've got Mohamed Wade, has to go high and very wide. Marcus Lopez looking to use his fullbacks in those positions, especially down the left hand side. On the right, he's got Yusuf, he's got that pace to run at Nasser, Lebanon's left wing back.
There's a free kick to Qatar, which is a chance for Afif to whip a ball in towards Matar's goal. Afif has just made his 100th appearance for the national team. Father was Somali international Hassan back in the old days. Good looking ball in, header from Mahdi. He's well saved low down by Matar, but the aerial presence once again of the central defender causing a few problems for that Lebanon defense, but a good save by the keeper.
I get enough of a touch on that. Mahdi took a bit of a deflection as well off Mansour. There's no one in a Qatari jersey following up on that. A little bit of a spill by Matar. Grateful his defenders were there for that protection. Nicely touched on.
Pushed away by Barsham. He had his positioning right, but it was a little bit unconvincing from the goalkeeper. But goalkeepers will tell you, just keep the ball out any way you can, and he did just that. Best chance of the game so far for Lennon.
Yeah, falling to Matuk here. Again, it's that flick on from Girardi, just drops off. You have that variation, the change up in the run. Girardi dropping in a little bit deeper. Matuk looking to make the run in behind. Plenty of power behind that effort. Barsham well positioned.
Was the first Lebanese player to reach 100 caps for the national team. Tussle going on as Girardi tries to burst forward. He's still got a little bit of time here to try and take on Pedro. No foul given that time. Yusuf. Matu. Despite the fact they've had less possession of the game, Lebanon have just settled into things a little bit more now as we approach the midway point of the first half. hesitation allows in Haidar in behind Pedro. Support arriving from Girardi. Haidar. Another long-range shot from Shaw. Just goes wide of the target, but just opening up a little for Lebanon to see a sight at goal.
Yeah, getting a bit of territory there, Lebanon. Being able to push the ball into more advanced areas. He's always going to take a special strike there from Shaw. Trouble, Barsham. Get a shot away. Marcus Lopez not too happy. He was given that time and space to unleash one towards goal.
Yeah, Qatar's record in 2019 was one of the best records really going through history when you consider there were 24 teams for the first time. Group wins over Saudi Arabia, Lebanon and North Korea. Iraq in the quarterfinals, Korea Republic in the semis, and then beat the host nation UAE 4-0 when Amoez Ali scored that fine goal in the final. So they did beat Lebanon 2-0 in the group stages in the last edition. Amoez Ali was on the score sheet then as well. Here's Youssef. Challenge by Nasser.
Well defended by Nasser. Stood his ground, no way through for Youssef. That was interesting about Qatar's starting lineup as well. You have Mendes and Madi, two central defenders who play for Al Wakra. Marcus Lopez very familiar with those two players. Boualem Kouki and Tariq Salman having to make do with a place on the bench. I was a little bit surprised as well that Kouki didn't get a start in this one. I'm surprised as well that the number 14, Homam, he was a very energetic left fullback, has to make do with a place on the bench this evening. Mistiming his run, Youssef. It's always disappointing in those situations when you're a wide player looking right across that defensive line and you mistime your runs from those positions.
Well taken again by Matu. There's space here, goes back across Marsham, but once again it's not a great finish. There's a good opportunity just opened up for Lebanon once more, but unable to take advantage from Zain.
No, he's made a good run forward there, Zain. Hossein Zain getting into a attacking area in a good position. It's much better from Lebanon in terms of being able to get support into Matuk and Girardi. It's going to be important for them. They are looking to play on the transition.
A good looking ball in towards Afif Youssef. Well won back. Only two players up ahead for Lebanon. Barsham's come a long way out of his goal. Youssef. Hatem. Well, Haidas. Fifth continues to pull the strings in that midfield area. Pedro.
Yeah, just look at them in this phase of possession here, 2 and 3. Afif being able to link up with Hassan Alhedos, one of those narrower central positions.
Well, here comes Afif. Once again, way to goal blocked. They've got plenty of goals throughout the team. Qatar all confident to try their luck from distance if they get a good sight at goal. Here's Afif once again. Amoez Ali up ahead of him. As was Mohamed Wideout on that far side.
Well, Qatar trying to get Afif and Alhaidos on the ball as much as they can in those areas. And that's why the positioning of Mohamed Wad is really important down the left. Gives them that width, allows Afif and Alhaidos to just push into more of those central positions, trying to outnumber Lebanon in those areas of the pitch. It's just a little bit too slow in terms of the pace of their passing and movement at the moment.
Almoez. On the clear by Nasser. Qatar did lose their final warm-up game against Jordan this time last week.
Looking like they're trying to overload Lebanon down that left-hand side.
The ball to Afif, nicely taken down as well. Looking to take on Zayn. A little reverse ball, just had too much on it once again. And frustrating in the final third again for Qatar, who haven't really tested Matar too much. There was the header from Mahdi from the set piece, but goalkeeper stood his ground well so far.
Made a couple of mistakes, Afif, with those passes into the final third. It's an intriguing game of football, with two very different styles, two different approaches here.
Good skills again from Girardi, just trying to get away from the attentions of Lucas Mendes, but it's another poor pass and what looked like, again, a relatively simple pass for Lebanon. And that will be the frustrating thing for a coach, that they're just not picking out players in the same colour shirt at times. Yusuf. Hatem. Looking to be threaded through by Ahidos to Yusuf. There's a slip by Lucas, allows Matu to take over. Girardi coming in support. There's only the two of them there, though. Defenders have comfortably dealt with that, with numbers in their favour. Robert Milky. Al-Haydos. Good ball over the top. Almoez is well onside this time. He's got Afif in the middle. Might be tempted to go on his own here, Almoez Ali. Good challenge by Mansour. Still not cleared, though. Takes a double deflection, comes off Almoez Ali. Al-Haydos was a little bit speculative with that. There were a lot of bodies in his way. And there's a Lebanon player gone down injured here after taking one square in the stomach. It's Short, who will maybe need a little bit of treatment. But once again, Qatar pressing forward and looking threatening.
A good movement off the ball there from Qatar in that forward line. Spoke about the mobility early. Almoez Ali this time around just peeling away, getting in behind the right side of Lebanon's defensive line. Great defending from Mansour, though. He had to be very patient. Time is challenged well. Just having another look at this shot from Al-Haydos into the back of Shur. Good to see him back up. Ready to go again.
This is the only game of the day today, but things start to get busy as of tomorrow. Three matches coming up. I'll tell you those in just a sec. Here's Yusuf. Teasing Nasser. Good ball in. A beach header. Flicks the top of the bar. Got off the ground really well there, Afif. It was a lovely ball in. But he just couldn't get any downward pressure on the ball, and it flicks off the top of the bar.
Yusuf not really getting too much joy on the outside of Nasser this time, just changes it up. Sends a cross in with his left foot. It's a late movement from Afif. Allows him to gain that momentum on his run and his leap. Getting to that cross ahead of Mansour. Couldn't quite get the dip required.
Won the Asian Footballer of the Year award in 2019, Akram Afif. You send those three matches coming up tomorrow. Australia against India, China, well, the People's Republic of China against Tajikistan, and the Islamic Republic of Iran against Palestine are the three games tomorrow. Of course, China, PR and Tajikistan in this group. Girardi's gone down injured here, so it'll just be another brief hold-up.
That's a little bit of a bump, a little lower back there for Girardi. From Fatih.
Coming up to 32 minutes gone then. The opening game at the AFC Asian Cup Qatar 2023. Still 0-0 between the host nation and Lebanon. But Qatar have had more of the ball, created more opportunities and had a goal disallowed very early on through Almawaz Ali when he was denied by the semi-automated offside decision. Shows the improvement that Qatar made, though, between 2015 and 2019. They failed to qualify for the group stages for the knockouts in Australia and then were unstoppable just 4 years later. Such was the work that Felix Sanchez did with them, with a lot of players that he knew from his days at Aspire Academy as well, which has produced so many great Qatari players over the last few years.
Such good young talent coming through. You think back to then, the likes of Akram Afif and Almawaz Ali, who are about 21, 22 years of age. Gained so much coming into this competition in the prime, you'd say. And they made such a huge impact back in 2019. It was such a good balance in that side. So Kuki Budiaf in central midfield as well for them. A player like Madibo, who unfortunately has missed out on the squad this time around. Real tank in central midfield.
Yeah, there is only one uncapped player in the Qatar squad, that's Ahmed El Ghani. Khaled Mohammed, another youngster as well, that's made just two appearances so far. So these are one or two of the players that they will look to bring through over the next few years. It's a corner conceded by Nasser.
Well, there is absolutely that need to regenerate the squad in certain departments. Got young players out there, like Tamim Mansour and Ahmad Al Rawi. Samal Tahiri, who unfortunately picked up an ACL injury. These are players in the future that can come in.
Driven in low by Al Haidos, just flicked on by Matu, which did enough to take it away from danger.
Tamim Mansour, in fact, being given opportunities under Carlos Queiroz. And I think Marquez Lopez, you can understand why he's gone with this squad. You can understand why he's gone with a lot of experience. He's gone with several players that he knows well. Missed time in Al Wakra. Didn't have too much of an opportunity to really work with the squad. And you need that familiarity from a coaching perspective. You need to know that the players, when you put them out on the pitch, they know exactly what you want from them. And there needs to be that trust.
49 places separate these two teams in the FIFA rankings. There's Youssef. Mahdi. Mendes. Almawaz Ali always looking to play off the shoulder of the central defender, Mansour, who went with him. Wad. Afif, who seems to pop up everywhere, rides the challenge of Nasser. Nice little reverse ball. Afif gets it back again, still has possession. Nicely pulled back, it's Hatoum. There's appeals for handball. Well, Qatar are furious. It probably will be one for VAR to check, of course, but play will continue for the moment. Away by Mansour. And the ball has now gone out of play. Or was this a handball?
Well, it happened so quickly. Yeah, that's striker's arm. But it's not extended away from his body. I think that might save him. It's up against his body. Yes, there's contact there, but it's not elevated. It's not in an unnatural position away from his body.
Errol Haidas just questioning that with the referee, Ali Raza Fagani. But there is no check, so play continues. Mahdi. Pedro. Great movement off the ball again from Qatar. Youssef with that little give and go.
And forget the penalty shout. That was much better from Qatar on the right-hand side. That link-up play. Din Hatem and Afif.
Here's Afif, got a little bit fortunate. It's Almawaz Ali, couldn't get the ball out of his feet. It almost spins for Youssef, but Matar was alive to the danger. But once again, the flag's gone up for offside against Youssef coming back from an offside position.
Yeah, I like that. I like the position that Afif takes up here. Almoez was clearly offside. Needs a little bit more discipline in those moments. Afif, when he's given that license to roam, he's so intelligent in the positions that he takes up. And they need that quickness in the tempo of their play. It's fine being patient in those moments. But once it gets into those attacking areas, those key areas of the pitch, that's when it needs to go really quickly. And we saw when they did that with the penalty shout in the move leading up to it, they were able to do some damage and cause a few issues for Lebanon.
Important touch from Nasser because Youssef was right behind him. But they're using the wings to good effect at the moment. Qatar, particularly down this near side where Afif has appeared, Almoaz Ali's appeared, Youssef's appeared. And then they just pop up somewhere else. It's very, very difficult to defenders to try and track them. Here's Mahdi. Fateh just got clipped as he played that ball away. Nice little spin away from Al-Haidos. Almoaz Ali, that clever movement along the line, trying to get away from Mansour. Al-Haidos, a great ball given away to Zayn. That will be a free kick to Qatar. They're just standing their ground, Lebanon, at the moment. When those two fullbacks drop in and make it the five at the back, then that's when Qatar have got to be very clever to try and create those opportunities in those gaps.
Well, you just saw it right there, Almoaz Ali. He was alone in the area. It was one against five, essentially, in that back line. They were trying to build something down the left. I'm not quite sure this experiment with Wade at left back is quite working out in this match. He's more of a central midfielder for me. Yes, he has played at left back. But I think they could benefit from perhaps that injection of pace, a bit more drive in those left fullback positions. Homam perhaps coming in there and adding a bit more of that intensity in his runs forward. Wade hasn't quite been involved in those wider positions for Qatar on the left-hand side.
As Qatari supporters doing their best to get behind their team. There's a good smattering of Lebanon supporters in here as well. So this final, the stadium will host the final on the 10th of February. Little flick on by Mansour, but nobody behind him. It'll be comfortably kept in by Barsham. Foul by Haidar. Scream from Pedro as that ball is played away, but just a little clip. No need for anything more than a little ticking off maybe from the referee.
It's a little bit late to that challenge, wasn't it?
The Lebanon have only won just one of their previous six matches at the two editions that they've competed in so far. That was over DPR Korea back in 2019 in the final group game. It wasn't enough to see them through to the knockout stages. Lovely ball in behind again. Youssef, nicely done, sends Nasser on to his backside. Pedro Al-Haidos. Lovely ball again, if Youssef can get there, but he just overran it slightly. But again, great vision from Al-Haidos just to slip that ball in between the fullback and defender. And Youssef just couldn't get his foot around it.
The first pass initially from Fatih. Youssef actually did really well to get past Nasser. And the decision-making, just letting him down. That first pass from Fatih, the defense-splitting pass, was excellent. He's having a good game, Qatar's number 20.
It's a poor goal kick again. Not the first time Matar has kicked the ball straight out of play. So I'm sure the frustration of his coach. Milky's header. comfortable here for Lucas Mendes to try and get Qatar moving forward once again. Fateh. Mahdi. Afif. Managed to get enough pace on that ball. Milky dealt with it comfortably. It's Mendes who's been dispossessed. Matu. It's a poor ball. They have got a throw-in out of it, though, thanks to Tanesh just sticking in a leg. But one or two of those little, what seemingly easy passes for Lebanon, just going a little bit astray at the moment.
That's not been enough quality from Lebanon. When they have possession, essentially going straight back to Qatar, putting themselves under pressure again. But it is difficult. You're drilled to be defensively sound, and when that's your tactical setup, then try and really change it up. Certain phases of the game, it can be a challenge, especially when the profiles of players aren't quite there for you to make a difference.
There's Pedro. Were the first team to be eliminated from the group stage of the World Cup last year, Qatar, after losing out to Ecuador, Senegal and the Netherlands. Youssef. Of course, those successes as well in 2019 led them to be invited out to the CONCACAF Gold Cup as well, when they got through to the semi-finals, lost out to the USA in 2021. Success breeds its own success when you win trophies.
Again, it's a chance to hang on to possession. It's gone straight back out. Well, just a moment before that, Girardi turning the wrong way. When it does go into him, nice to be able to hang on to it.
Al-Haidos. Away again by Mansour. Those three central defenders have done a pretty solid job in this first half so far. Just that one header, one from Mahdi from the set piece, and then Afif getting a little flick on a ball which came off the top of the crossbar. But apart from that, they've managed to soak up most of the Qatar pressure. Wad hooked across towards Youssef, who rose highest. Was Al Mouazzali coming back? Afif guides it into the bottom corner, and having been denied a goal early on, although Lebanon are claiming there's been a foul on the edge of the area in the build-up, but Akram Afif will celebrate another international goal for Qatar, number 27 for him, and the host nation, having been denied a goal by the semi-automated offside early on, have taken the lead here on the stroke of half-time. It's Qatar 1, Lebanon 0.
Tidy, tidy finish from Afif, keeps his composure, doesn't go for power, goes for control. But this is all Youssef. Really, I mean, this cross from Wad is just lofted into the area. Youssef with that leap. Side foot finish. Clever touchback by Al Mouazzali. And it's Afif in those positions once again. When he gets that license to roam, he's so difficult to pick up. Late run into the area from deep. Not tracked by Lebanon's midfield. A nice, cool finish, and that trademark celebration from Afif, who's having a stunning season, scoring a goal for Al Saad.
Well, Lebanon thought they should have had a free kick for the foul by Youssef on the edge of the area, but just looked to be a fairly solid challenge. It was an aerial challenge, and Youssef was just stronger in that challenge.
It was a well-timed lead from Youssef.
Saying the player that went down. Well, just the tonic they needed in first half stoppage time, Qatar. Well, made them breathe a little easier now. As we said earlier on, the pressure will be on the host nation, of course, and holders. Expected to lead from the front in the competition. If they can get 3 points here, then gives you a better than good chance of making it through with the extended numbers, of course.
Well, that is the goal they needed, Qatar. It is going to force a change in the complexion of this game. Lebanon have to open up. Now they have to be decided to take the chances, to take the risk going forward.
When you look at Qatar's record over the last 12 months, they haven't had the best of times. Just 6 wins in 17 matches over the calendar year of 2023. But the big crowd doing their best to get right behind them here in this wonderful stadium in Lusail. The last game that was played here of any great note was the World Cup final, the stage graced by Lionel Messi and Kylian Mbappe, among others. Minutes of added time to go at the end of the first half. Girardi. Lebanon will be disappointed not to have got through to half-time, having, we say, defended resolutely. They survived a couple of scares, but yeah, they hadn't managed to concede a goal, and to concede that late would always change the team talk for the coach at half-time.
Oh, he's going to have to change it up, I think, quite drastically. Radulovic would have gone in at 0-0. He would have been pretty happy with the way it's gone in terms of the overall result, but perhaps not too happy with the attacking phases of play.
They get something. The minutes or the seconds that remain. It's sliced out of play by Almo Azali on that far side.
He is going to have to just re-look that aspect in possession for Lebanon. They're relying on these long throws, these long passes forward. Girardi's not exactly doing a great job of holding it up.
Throw in again, there's a collision between Fateh and Mendes, his own player. These long throws are a way for Lebanon to try and get the ball into the danger area, although Qatar have been pretty solid at the back in terms of winning balls in the air in this first half. Once again, there's no white shirt anywhere near that. Still 5 in the middle to aim for, though. Goes deep to Tanish. Now Afif. Nasser that went across, and Haidar's been caught right in front of the Lebanon bench. It's a wag of the finger from Marquez Lopez.
It's just Youssef running across Haidar. He's trying to indicate that there was an elbow in there. There's always this auto-appeal from players.
Well, the referee has blown the whistle for half-time. It was looking like a frustrating half for Qatar, who had a goal disallowed early on through Almo Azali after the automated offside decision came in. Mahdi had a header. Afif hit the top of the bar, but then a nice, cool, composed finish, sliding the ball into the bottom corner, gave Akram Afif the goal that puts his side ahead at half-time.
Well, they've had the chances, Qatar. They finally found the breakthrough. Changes the complexion of things for the second half. The team talks are going to be very different now for Marquez Lopez and Miodrag Radulovic. They really need a big change at halftime in terms of their attacking approach, Lebanon, and much better quality when they do have the ball.
Well, the crowd expects, and they expect more goals from their team in the second half. But Qatar do have a slender lead at halftime. It's Qatar 1, Lebanon 0 in the opening game. earlier on as well. Just really setting the tone and setting the colour. So it is Lebanon in white that will get us underway at the start of the second half. So they defended manfully in that first half, but nothing they could do with that finish from Akram Afif. That little side foot into the bottom corner past Matar. What can they do in response in this second half? I'm sure we'll see plenty of changes from both sides as the second half wears on, but for the moment, the personnel is the same as that finished the first half.
Yeah, and the quality in possession from Lebanon has really got to go up. Now, Girardi needs to have a bigger impact up front for Lebanon in terms of how he's able to hang on to it, but it does get played into him. There's no doubt that goal has really changed the way this match is going to go. Qatar will be a little bit more relaxed, getting that open up. Fine finish from Afif. Again, for Qatar's very much keep doing what you've been doing.
Did have a goal disallowed in that first half. Afif hit the top of the crossbar with a glancing header. But Lebanon haven't really showed too much. Matu and Girardi have worked hard up front, but they haven't found any spaces between the four Qatar defenders, Pedro, Mahadi, Mendes and Ward. Ward playing slightly out of position, but doing a good job in the left-back role. There he is with the throw. Away by Mansour. Was helped on by Matu. Haidar on the chase, takes a tumble. Shot is deflected wide from Girardi for the first corner of the second half.
Lucas Mendes just struggling for pace there. It's good work from Haidar. He's actually looked the sharpest, I would say, of not exactly Lebanon's front three, but with the way they set up, I'm going to say he's part of that front three. He's playing that attacking midfield role, looking to try and support Matuk and Girardi. Just quick to that, Haidar. And he's having to do such a difficult job as well because he's part also of that midfield setup. Three in central midfield, so he's got to work very hard defensively and then get forward and try and support the attack.
I've got a corner here, Lebanon.
Let's go!
Not too much movement inside the area. At the moment, it's back out to Haidar. I think that ball had probably gone out of play anyway before it was headed back across. So another opportunity really passes them by. Robert Melky.
Yeah, Haidar with his head in his hands there. He knows quality on that delivery wasn't good enough, but far too much on that.
Yeah, did go unbeaten in their first four qualifying matches. Lebanon, of course, the qualification in Asia is quite complicated. It was the second round of World Cup qualification that saw them go through. They drew 0-0 with the Korea Republic, which was one of the standout results. Robert Milky in that game kept Son Heung-min quiet. Not too many players can boast that feat over the last few years. They did lose their last two qualifiers against Turkmenistan and the return against the Korea Republic, but they've done enough to secure a second spot in the group and book their place here in Qatar. Take on China next, Lebanon in Al Tamama. Was forward by Tinesh. Yusuf coming deep to win the ball back. Not a great ball forward though, looking for Al-Mu'az Ali.
They played a big part in that opener for Qatar. And Yusuf, great leap, really well timed. And Nasser, though, I think has done a pretty good job in terms of trying to defend those one-on-ones against Yusuf. I don't think he's been able to get really too much joy in terms of getting around on the outside of Nasser.
Five years ago, we had 30 goals in 51 matches. So a high-scoring tournament, averaging just over 2.5 goals a game. Just a single goal in this one so far, the opening match here in Qatar. It's good to see the attendances as well. There was a total of just over 640,000 watch the matches in the UAE. Already that number has been exceeded by quite some distance with the ticket sales for the matches coming up already. There's a rather dramatic fall there from Fateh.
Yeah, again, he's quick to come across. It was just a straight challenge there from Haidar. You can see he makes that connection. A bit of a kick out at Fatih. And there is a yellow card here for Haidar.
Our first yellow card of the tournament. Two yellow cards in the group stages, and well, two yellow cards would mean a suspension.
Fatih again having a really solid game. Very assured in possession, he keeps it simple. So he reads the danger well. On the defensive side of things, there he is, looking to get to that ahead of Haidar.
There's Al Haidar. It's given away to Matu. Girardi on a forward run again, but nobody in the middle. It'll be comfortable for Barsham to gather. Afif, man whose goal separates these two teams.
He's just so much fun to watch, Afif. He's so good in possession. Very creative. There he is again, trying to get in behind Lebanon's midfield line. And have to keep track of him. Dinesh has finally spotted his movement. Coming across, forcing the pass back. There he is again, Afif.
Al Haidar almost instinctively know where each other are, these Qatari midfielders. Fateh was a Mir Cup winner with Al Arabi last season, well, the 2023 season. It's a foul on Matu, be a free kick to Lebanon.
Yeah, I think it's actually smart play here from Fatih. No danger of picking up a caution there. There's no chance for Lebanon to actually break forward. Qatar looking to make a change here.
Yeah, first change by either coach coming right at the start of the second half. Ismail is going to come on. Another very experienced player making a 78th international appearance, the man from Al Dahail. Cut out again by Mendes. Al Haidar. Caught in possession by Tanesh. Zane. Nicely done. Surrounded by four, but you can see the shape that Qatar have got at the moment, making it very difficult for Lebanon to even get a shooting chance at goal. Away by Mahdi. Zane. Well, keep plugging away, Lebanon. Tanish. Zane.
Well, they're showing much better control in possession here, Lebanon. The connections are a lot better than we saw in that first half. Just holding off there because I didn't want to put the commentator's curse on Hussein Zane. Thought he was going to turn it over there. But they've hung on to this really well. They're starting to get the players a little bit closer together when they do have the ball. Well, the curse has eventually struck as Matu gives away a free kick.
It's going to be a double change for Qatar because Mustafa is going to come on as well. So wasting no time at the start of the second half, maybe feeling that Lebanon are having a little bit too much of the ball for his liking. Marquez Lopez. Maher Hardy. There will always be that sense of nervousness around with a 1-0 lead, of course. Al-Haidos. Now the other thing, of course, these days is football's not a 90-minute game anymore. We're expecting stoppage time to be added in. In answer to any time wasting or things that go on in the second half, of course, that was something that was introduced at the World Cup really for the first time. Have to plan much better now in terms of changes in personnel. Here's Wad. Great looking ball in, simple chance! And Almo Azali doesn't miss from there. The man who scored 9 goals 5 years ago is off the mark, denied one in the first half, but not this time. You deliver quality to a quality striker and he will get you goals. And Qatar now lead by 2-0.
You just have a look at how Qatar opened that space up for Wad. The interchange of passes down their left-hand side. And he gets all the time in the world to put a beautiful ball in for Almoez. Easily dispatched by the star forward. Let's have a look at this here. That link up there between Al-Haidos and Afif. The triangle down the left. Wad just peels away, uses that width. Lebanon's defense on that side just dragged out of position. Hussein Zain, not quite sure who to pick up in those situations. And that's really well finished by Almoez as well. No chance for Matar. So prolific the last edition of this competition, scoring 9 goals from just 10 shots on target. You see those changes coming in.
Yeah, Youssef and Al-Haidos are the two players going off. Also, Mustafa and Ismail are the players coming on. Well, Almo Azali scored a hat-trick in a friendly on New Year's Eve against Cambodia. Coming into this in good form. We know all about his goal-scoring prowess, and he's edging closer to 50 international goals now.
It's an interesting one with Almoez, because he doesn't score too many on the domestic front. But with Qatar, he's been banging them in. He scored 4 goals against Afghanistan in a qualifier recently, and a goal against India as well. Here he is again.
Yeah, it's just going to beat him into touch. He scored 4 goals against DPR Korea in the 2019 edition. 4 goals in 51 minutes, the second fastest behind Ali Dai, who managed the same feat for Iran against Korea Republic. It's Matar. Now Mansour. Well, this was the same scoreline when these sides met in the group stages in the UAE. Ali was on the score sheet there with the second goal after Al-Rawi had put Qatar in front. Another Qatar substitution coming up. Chance for Marquez Lopez to ring those changes. And Mustafa coming on to make up a 14th international appearance. Ismail Mohammed from Al Dahail is vastly experienced, 33-year-old.
Perfect for Qatar. Great for Marquez Lopez being able to make those changes. 2 goals up.
Well, they take on the competition newcomers next. Tajikistan at Al Bayt on the 17th. Qatar. We'll get our first look at Tajikistan tomorrow when they take on China PR. Here's Afif. Stabbed down the line for Ismail, but always favouring El Zain to get there first, although Matar took an extra touch and almost allowed the substitute a side to the ball. Zain, good challenge again in midfield. Having come out slightly second best at the start of the second half, that goal has just lifted Qatar's spirits.
It was Lebanon who were trying to find a reaction, looking for that response and a bit more possession. Qatar just being patient, working that opening and that opportunity to make it 2-0.
Lovely ball again by Afif. Fateh. Afif. Flip was from Amo Azali. It was a little bit nonchalant, but they've still managed to keep possession here with Wad, but couldn't keep the ball in play, though.
He just put that out for a goal kick, and he's signalled straight away to the bench that he wants to be taken off.
Lebanon about to make their first change. Al Helway is going to come on, but Qatar back on the attack once again. Good defending.
A bit of cramp there for Abdelaziz. That's good pressing, good pressure. Mansour is turning it over. Well, both players feeling a bit of cramp. Almoez as well is going down with a bit of cramp.
There's four players down at the moment. There's two on the edge of the area. Yeah. We'll have a look at that chance again.
Yeah, you just see Hussein Zain's been just dragged all the way across to come and take care of Alhedo. So spill out wide. As we have a look at that semi-automated offside technology, he's quite clear. He's in an onside position. Peels away from his marker quite nicely. Mansour just moves away on the blind side of the centre-back. That's a really good control header. Very good finish from Al Moezali. Quality of that delivery from Wad. But the way Qatar were able to just open up that space for Wad, they have all that time. Put that ball in. That was really impressive. Afif as well coming in, and because he's drifting across in those central attacking areas, he's causing all sorts of problems for Lebanon. So difficult for them to pick up. That overload working for them very well down the left once again.
That's Shaw just being helped back to his feet. There was the challenge, the collision with Almoez. The one on the edge of the area. And there was the second one.
It looks like Shore's gone back down and he's asking for a change as well.
It's always a worry for a coach in these tournaments if players do get injured, because there's not a huge amount of recovery time between games.
Yeah, absolutely right. Positive thing for Radulovic, though, is that he's got lots of options in those defensive midfield positions, such as his makeup of the squad. He's got players who can fill in at centre-back and in defensive midfield.
Well, both teams are players down at the moment. Now Mansour comes back on. Elmo Azali comes back on as well. Lebanon are still a player short. They're waiting to make the substitution. There's a little flick. It's just helped over his own bar by El Zain.
Clever bit of play. Nice bit of invention from Mustafa Mashal. Goalkeeper's gone down now, clutching his hamstring.
Matar received a bit of treatment in the first half after a collision. But he's only got a bit of a problem here as well, which is adding another stoppage onto things.
Well, you wonder if this is a sign of the lack of preparation time, lack of intensity, perhaps in the training and in the build-up towards it. They haven't had that much time, we've already mentioned that, in the lead-up to this competition. And players just perhaps struggling with the pace of the game, with the intensity. Although, I don't think you really expect that from goalkeepers. Intensity not very high in those positions.
Well, Shaw is coming back on at the moment, still hobbling a little bit though. They're just going to hold off on the substitution, I think, just for a moment.
There's Jon Anderson and the Hong Kong China coaching staff. And the crowd just having a look.
So corner to Qatar, they lead by 2-0. Bit of pushing going on as always on the edge of the area. A Still the referee's not happy that everybody's staying within the letter of the law. As Ali tried to get away from his man, and now the referee will threaten the yellow cards, I think, if any more of that, El Zayn and Almoez. Now we do have the corner. It took a slight deflection, it's bobbling around in the area, but eventually Lebanon managed to get the ball away through Milky.
It was really brave there, Mendes, just going in. Did enough defensively there, Lebanon, to clear their lines in the end. It was Melky.
Mendes. Mahdi. A triple change about to be made by Lebanon in just a moment. We'll have some more defending to do here first. Mendes has carried on his run. Milky tidies up again. Girardi gives the ball away once more. Mustafa. Wad.
He's so nice and composed in possession, is Mustafa. 22-year-old. Another one you look at in terms of the long-term future of Qatar's national team. In the here and now, making an impact as well. Found himself on the score sheet in their qualifiers.
Qatar didn't have the best of times in their early participations of the Asian Cup. Did reach the quarterfinals on a couple of occasions, but they've still lost more games than they've won in this competition over the years. This one is going well for them at the moment, though. Ismail wins the ball back, the substitute. Vastly experienced Ismail, six-time winner of the QSL League. There's Afif just overrunning that one slightly. Tanish. Now Milky. Pace on that ball to pick up Matu. Haidar forced back towards his own goal. Still those three substitutions waiting to happen. Down on the sidelines for Lebanon. We're into the final quarter of this opening match at the Asian Cup Qatar 2023. Match 1 of 51. It's this expanded tournament now after it was made up to 24 teams in 2019, giving a lot more of the Asian nations a chance to qualify for this event. We mentioned those sides coming in this year, four different teams from 5 years ago. Hong Kong, Indonesia, Malaysia and Tajikistan, the four teams missing out. North Korea, Turkmenistan, Yemen and the Philippines. Lebanon on the attack, looking for a goal that would just get them back into it. It almost finds its way through to Girardi, but good defending by Qatar, and now those substitutions will be made.
Well, such an important challenge there from Mahdi. Getting himself into that position. Got a toe in, just about, Mahdi. I think he was exactly well positioned there. Had to really stretch for it, as we see the triple change here.
Now Shaw is coming off to be replaced by Shraw. Fourth official earning his money. Alelway and Shaban are the other two players that are coming on. Matu is making way. Substitutions for Lebanon, number 16, Shaban player number 7, Hudson player number 11, Haidar. So Omar Shaban, who plays for AFC Wimbledon in England. Shaban.
good header away again. Solid header that from Mahadi. Four players offside there, I think. So half-hearted swing at the ball goes straight through to Barsham.
It's fresh legs in midfield for Lebanon with Sarur in there. Number 25, Shur was struggling. We got Sarur, another one of those young players for Lebanon coming through.
Zwad. Overhit the cross, there was no one in the middle. Able to get on the end of that one from Wad, just overhit it.
Two in central midfield there. Sarur and Ali Tanesh just in front of them. Basil Zradi has dropped off into that attacking midfield role. Ilal El Helwe now leading the line. Alongside Omar Shaban.
Another change about to be made by Qatar as well. Homam is going to come on. Here's Zradi. Trying to find that through to Shaban. Akram Afif in first half stoppage time and Almoez Ali in the second half getting the goals for Qatar. That's put them into a 2-0 lead here in their opening match in defence of their Asia Cup trophy. Here comes the change. It is Wad that's going off. He has to be substituted a while ago, having picked up a knock, but they are now making the change. Homam comes on, moves to within one of 50 appearances for Qatar.
Just running out of gas there. Mohamed Wad, big contribution, played a part in the opener. Big part in the second, picking up the assist. And a lovely cross to Almoez. I think he struggled in the first half to really have much of an attacking impact. And in the second, with that second goal for Qatar, we're able to create that space for him very well, and he used his quality. And now we get to see Homam on a different style of fullback. More pace, more energy.
Did score one of his three international goals in that CONCACAF Gold Cup tournament back in 2021 against Honduras.
Omama, real modern attacking fullback.
Striding right back on the edge of his own penalty area. Milky. He's looking to press into a little bit of space. Qatar will just back off. They know that 2-0 lead, but again, 2-0 lead we know can be quite fragile. Next goal could be important. You can see Qatar continuing to dominate with the ball, and that's reflected in the scoreline as it stands.
Well, you're absolutely right. You'll be happy, Qatar, in certain situations just to sit back and let Lebanon have the ball, especially if you've got that sort of quality out there, Lebanon, and how they are passing it. It's been really poor. An unforced error there from Ali Tanesh, stunning it over. They've got it back now.
Shaban in the middle, took it on the chest, just too heavy the touch, though. Well, there's a nice little ball floated in, but Omar Shaban didn't quite have the touch that he needed.
Just a bit too much on that touch of the chest from Shaban. Closer into him, softer touch there from Shaban, and Mendes would have been in a bit of trouble.
Yeah, Shaban, who'd been mainly non-league football in the UK before getting promoted with Sutton United into the English Football League. Scored their first ever league goal against Forest Green, one of his former clubs, back in his early days there. Here he is again, Shaban, looking to put himself around since coming on. Zradi, nowhere near where Al Helwe was waiting.
No, he's not had a good game at all, Basil Zradi. Being called up, and There's a lot expected of Basil Zrari. Expected to be a big player, an important player for Lebanon. Hasn't quite shown up for them in this match. There's still time in this competition to turn things around.
Yeah, he's an interesting character, Girardi, because he played the opening 90 minutes against Qatar in that tournament 5 years ago, but then he had a big fallout with the coach and didn't feature again in the tournament. But obviously they've patched up their differences. 82,490 is the attendance. Another player down injured here, it's Almo Azali.
I might have quite a bit of time added on at the end, but not due to VAR. The fact that lots of these players have gone down needing treatment. I don't think they're going to take any chances here. They're looking to make that change.
To lose Almo Azali through injury, but they won't take any chances, of course, if there is a just a little bit of a risk here with another game coming up in 5 days' time.
Yeah, another look at that lovely finish from Almo Azali. It's a movement as well, gets away from his marker. Mansour just ball watching, looking to play out wide. Almo Azali identifies that, knows that the defender is not watching him, peels away off the blind side. Still some work to do. Great quality in the delivery. Nice leap, nice control header to the bottom corner. And it's the smart thing to do. You don't want to take chances. Opening match of the competition. Looking very comfortable. Two-goal lead. Not really under any sort of threat. Take him off, get some fresh legs on. Don't think it's an injury that's going to be too serious. Almo Azali.
It's going to be Ahmed Aladin from Al Harafa that's going to come on. Another player with a massive international appearance. He's over 60 now for him. So there's such experience in this group of players, and they are making their final two changes. So Aladin is going to come on to replace Almo Azali, and we're also going to see Jassim coming on as well in place of Hatem Aziz. So that's five changes made now by Marcos Lopez. Qatar have got a corner as they look to try and extend their lead here, leading by 2-0. Jassim Gaber, who was part of the 2022 World Cup squad, player that's been at Al Arabi all his career, hasn't scored an international goal. What an introduction this would be if he could get his head on this. It doesn't quite reach him. It would just be a goal kick.
Lucas Mendes again just gone flying in, trying to meet this delivery from Afif, and he climbs very well. He's annoyed with himself. Pretty clear header. Can I get the control on that?
Al Helway. Shaban. Again, it's just a fraction too high. He takes it round the goalkeeper, almost round the ball over the goal line, but manages to keep things alive. It's hooked away by Fateh.
He just keeps going, doesn't he? Shaban doesn't give up on this. Was a lot for him to do with the ball that was initially played in. It might have gone up for a goal kick anyway. It would have been an interesting one had that ended up in the back of the net.
Gabriel Bita has come on for Lebanon. It is Girardi that's gone off this time. pace here from Homam. It's going to be yellow card. Shaw. So he joins his captain, or he joins Haidar in the book.
Very good speed from Homam. Very direct as well. Painful one for Homam, as his leg is planted as Sarur actually goes through it. We've seen players get seriously injured in those challenges. Foot planted into the turf, you get that force coming in on the back of your leg.
Yeah, we mentioned earlier on about winning your opening game in this tournament, getting the 3 points on the board, because it does mean that the coach can, if he wants to, maybe rotate the squad, especially with Qatar playing Tajikistan, the newcomers, in the next game. And then that gives them a few more days to take on China at the Khalifa International Stadium. Maybe get back to your full strongest team against the Chinese. But be interested to see the tactics in terms of team selection that Marquez Lopez goes with. It's not a great ball in, just in front of everybody and easily for Matar to gather and try and set Lebanon moving forward. If they could get a goal, Lebanon would just lift their spirits for the final 10 minutes or so. Will be quite a substantial chunk of added time, I think, to add on at the end of the match.
Yeah, certainly get Qatar nervous, make things really interesting for the rest of us. Just going back to the changes that Marquez Lopez could possibly think about or possibly make these upcoming matches. Obviously, we'll have to analyze the strengths of the opposition against Tajikistan and China. But one of the things that
we might fall here for Tanish. I think the free kick has already been given for an earlier foul. I thought he'd won the corner there, Tanish, because he found himself in a little bit of space in the area, but referee has pulled that back for an earlier foul.
Yeah, it was on Noor Mansour. Just back again to a couple of Qatari defenders. Free kick has been given for that. I was just going to say, before that throw-in, Marquez Lopez, the changes that he's made have worked very well. His selection has been proven right. Some things he might think about keeping on for the next couple of matches or so. Fati in central midfield has been very good. Afif as well, enjoying himself in that free role. Doing lots of damage to the opposition.
Chase on here for Ismail, but well managed to keep that one in play. Well, it has gone very much to plan so far for Marquez Lopez. Only appointed, as we mentioned, in December when he replaced Carlos Quiroz. Al Helway. Challenged by two, but still manages to come away with a loose ball. Given straight back to Fateh. Mustafa. Lucas Mendes. I'm sure Qatar will look just to try and keep hold of the ball as long as they can.
Yeah.
Just run the clock down now.
It's that aspect of game management that comes into it for Qatar now. I don't want to make any silly mistakes, any errors that give Lebanon the opportunity to get themselves back into the game. Keep the opposition moving. It's pretty well constructed, that phase of possession. Then a final pass. That's an applause from Afif. Mustafa Mashal, you can see the intent behind that pass that was played through. Just too narrow for Homam.
Tanisha's just been caught right in front of the referee, who saw nothing untoward with the challenge, but Tanisha's stayed down. They have still got one substitute to make, Lebanon, and they're about to make that now, but they might just hold on for a second. It's Saad that's going to come on. And in fact, the referee's going to pull that back and give a yellow card to Aladdin for the challenge.
It was good refereeing to let the first one go. Let's allow the play to continue. The advantage to Lebanon. Second one here is quite clear. It's a bit of a forearm into the ribs of the play as well. Tanish is okay.
What can they do from the free kick? Nassar is over the ball. Here comes the change. In fact, Nassar it is that's going off, so he won't be taking the free kick. Saad will come on. So both sides have now made... Lebanon have made five substitutions. Qatar just the four at the moment. Headed back into danger. It's back in again by Zayn. Given away, a thief. Homam. Oh, a thief just slipped, it just runs out of... Chaban, Chaban's chance! Across the face of goal, wasn't too far away from Omar Chaban, who's looked lively since coming on. Couldn't hit the target.
Marcos Lopez is not happy at all with that. And we were just talking moments ago about not giving Lebanon any of these opportunities, not making these mistakes. Chaban having a sight that goal. It well wide in the end. I think that was really going to trouble Barsham. But this lack of quality in possession has really hurt Lebanon. Real cutting edge in attack. I mentioned in the earlier stages of this match, you wonder where the chance creation, where the goals are really going to come from. And that is a concern.
Afif looking to get in behind. There's a shoulder-to-shoulder challenge. He got back to his feet very quickly. There was no real appeal. It was a shoulder-to-shoulder given away. Aladi. Lebanon can't get the ball clear. They do manage to get it away from danger now up towards Chaban, who did well just to guide that one off into the path of Bitar. But once again, too many Qatar shirts around him to allow him any space to try and find gaps going forward. Afif off the shoulder again. That was a close one. So not a good cross, cut out by Milky.
Yeah, not the best of decisions from Afif there. He was outnumbered in the box, Aladdin. I think he had to perhaps hang on to it, Afif.
Bit of frustration there for Al Helway, who wanted that played into feet from Bitar, but almost hit it against him. Zayn. Saad just manages to ride the challenge. Here he is again, 2-2 aim for in the middle. Great ball across, just out of the reach of Chaban, who just dangled out a leg, but not enough to get any purchase on the ball. It was a great ball in, one of the best balls we've seen really from Lebanon behind the Qatar defence, but once again they've been unable to convert it.
He's got the yellow card here as well, Pedro. Well, he makes his way towards the near post, tries to cut out that cross from Saad, and there was a bit of a shove in the back from Chaban. I think that's what he was unhappy about. Protested a little bit too much.
And Pedro into the book.
Another look at that challenge in the box there on Afif. It is shoulder to shoulder, isn't it? A good old-fashioned challenge there between Hussein Zain and Afif.
So 10 minutes added time at the end of the game. There were a lot of injuries at the start of the second half, which led to those stoppages. So still plenty of time. Aladdin. Was Mustafa just getting there first? Akram Afif, who's still full of running, even at this late stage of the game, having scored that opening goal for Qatar.
Yeah, just it really does look too easy for him, Afif. Popping up and all sorts of areas on the pitch. Beautiful switch, diagonal there from Mendes.
Whipped in again by Afif, flicked away by Zain. Tanish. Zain. Shepherded back easily by Mahadi to Barsham. Well, they'll regroup after this, Lebanon. So they know they've still got two more games to go, of course. They know that there's spots for the four best third-place teams in the groups. China and Tajikistan to come. Tanish. Zain. El Helway. Milky. Still can't find any space in behind at the moment. Again, it's aimed in towards Shaban. Tidied up once again by that very strong Qatar defence. Only conceded one goal in their qualifying campaign. That was against Oman. And they've been strong in defence here as well, having not had the best of 2023s, as we mentioned earlier on, in terms of playing record. In again, Shaban's header straight at the goalkeeper. What a chance for Omar Shaban, the substitute. He seemed odds on to score then. It was a brilliant ball in, and he's headed it straight at Barsham, who could hardly believe his luck.
I love the weight on the pass there. Beautifully floated in. It was by Gabriel Bitar. Just lifted it in to the area, onto the head of Shaban. He should have done better. He actually had support in the form of Hilal El Helway to his left. Nodded it down for him.
Important header there by Mansour, because Aladdin was right behind him. El Helway.
It's taken Lebanon a long time to get a chance like that. Best opportunity of this match.
Afif trying to bend that one into the path of Ismail. Quite come off for him. Bitar. Put that ball in a moment or so ago. Sure. Mansour. Zain happy to guide it all the way back to Matar, but not what's needed at the moment with the ball to be that deep in their own half. We've played just over 4 minutes of the 10 added on. Hooked away by Ismail. Aladdin pressing once again. He's looked lively since coming on and dangerous when pressing in that final third. Aladdin.
Now that freshness coming on. Just running around, Aladdin trying to make a nuisance of himself. They're disrupting a few attacks from Lebanon.
Thank you. side tussling away, but once again just that muscle off the ball by Fateh, who's had a good game in that holding midfield role tonight for Qatar. Pedro, don't forget three matches for you tomorrow: Australia against India, Australia the 2015 winners, China PR against Tajikistan, and Islamic Republic of Iran against Palestine. That's given away cheaply again. Akram Afif just presses the accelerator, still going Afif, lovely finish, and that will shoot it up, put the seal on it. A wonderful night for Qatar here in Lusail, because Akram Afif has his second goal of the game. I'm not too sure where he's going, but he has scored, and he's going to celebrate with the crowd, because that now means Qatar are going to win this comfortably by 3-0. There may be time for even more yet, but Afif has his second of the match, and Qatar, the defending champions, are heading for a win on the opening day.
Outstanding. A brilliant performance by Akram Afif. I was just thinking before he scored that goal, between him and Fateh for my man of the match, it's going to Akram Afif now. Just let's have a look at this acceleration here. Again, he's in that space, that pocket of space. Just drops off Lebanon's back line. They're so open in midfield as they try and chase the game here. But that acceleration, how easy was that? Oh, he makes it look easy. And then the composure here to just lift it past Matar. He's had such a good game, Akram Afif. He's made a massive impact in this one for Qatar. An absolute star.
Well, he was considered to be one of the most promising players to emerge from Qatar earlier on in his career when he graduated from the Aspire Academy. And now he's still living up to that hype now, even though he's an established international. And flicked away by Pedro. El Zain. Good block by Pedro, just trying to G the crowd up and get them making some noise. Quite a considerable amount have left the stadium, so they won't have seen that third goal. But it's been a wonderful night here for the opening day of this AFC Asian Cup Qatar 2023. And the first of many nights to come over the next 4 weeks or so. Here's Short. It's a header from Mansour, but again, no power on it at all, comfortable for Balsham.
Similar sort of diagonal pass played by Sarur. Put one in earlier for that opportunity. Wasn't taken by Shaban. Just really running out of ideas. I say running out, I don't think they've had many ideas in attack, Lebanon. Now that recovery, how they respond, how they rebound from this, it's going to be fascinating. Can they take a more proactive approach in the upcoming matches? Are they going to stick with this?
And a free kick to Qatar. Aladdin with a fouled rather. It did suffer 4-0 defeats in each of the last two editions, Lebanon against Iran and DPR Korea. For Afif to turn provider. He was into double figures with the assists in 2019. Now he's scoring goals as well. What can he do here? Great delivery. Homam. Pedro. Fateh still looking strong in midfield. Ismail, Jassim, getting a shooting chance himself here. Wasn't too far away. Matar wasn't too sure initially where that was going.
Oh, worth a try there from Jassim. Just opened up for him. Well, wide in the end, wasn't it? From Jassim. Well, why not? That's late stage of the match. Just have a go.
Matar again clears the ball straight out of play. And those Lebanon fans will hope that they can recover from this and come back stronger in their second game, because this has been a great performance by Marquez Lopez's side in his first major tournament, having come in to carry on the good work that was done, of course, by Felix Sanchez back in 2019. And his mainstay players were on the mark once again. Akram Afif getting a couple of goals. Almo Azali, who was substituted. But Qatar showing they're not going to give this trophy up lightly.
Yeah, the approach was very good. We asked the question, and they stand up to the pressure. The expectations coming into this as defending champions after poor showing at the World Cup. They've delivered on opening night, Qatar. Akram Afif, just brilliant for them. Very strong performance in that free roll. He's given license to roam, and he's done a lot of damage. And they'll move on. They've got a big 3 points here, Qatar. A nice platform to build for Lebanon now. The response is so important going into the next couple of games. They wish to qualify from the group.
Well, he could have had a hat-trick, of course, Afif, because he did scrape the top of the bar with a header in the first half as well. So it could have been an even better night for the man who clearly is a big talisman in this Qatar side. And if all their big players step up on the day, they are going to be very difficult to beat in this tournament. Someone's going to have to come up with something a little bit special.
Yeah, they certainly are, especially with the way they defended, I think, tonight. There will be tougher challenges ahead, can only play what's in front of them. But they were very disciplined. That man right there, Fatih, did a great job of screening that defence. Lucas Mendes and Mahdi Ali were very stable at the back alongside Pedro as well. And overall, I think, you know, Marquez Lopez will be delighted with the way it's gone. His changes, his lineup, have all worked very well for him in this one. And his players have responded to the faith that he's put in them.
Well, Lebanon will have to go regroup. There's still plenty of time for them to qualify, of course, with the extra places available. But Qatar will celebrate their opening win here in the Lusail Stadium. It's been a great night for them tonight, and they are comfortable winners in the first match of this AFC Asian Cup in Qatar 2023. It's finished Qatar 3, Lebanon 0.